What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. The java.concurrent.atomic package contains many classes that allow us to perform atomic operations. And as a reminder, an atomic operation is an operation that can't be broken down, and that can be safely executed in parallel on multiple threads without using the synchronized keyword or locks detailed in the previous video of this series. Internally, atomic classes make use of the compare and swap atomic instruction. Those instructions usually are much faster than synchronizing via locks. So, make use of atomic classes instead of locks in case you just have to change a single mutable variable concurrently. Now, let's pick one of the atomic classes, for example, atomic integer. By using atomic integer as a replacement for integer, we're able to increment the number concurrently in a thread-safe manner without synchronizing the access to the variable. The method increment and get is an atomic operation, hence can be called from multiple threads at the same time. The basics of atomic variables and atomicity were explained in the video linked in the card above. Now, in addition to what we just saw, we have the method update and get, which accepts a lambda expression that performs arbitrary arithmetic operations on the input. In the example you see, we updated our input by multiplying 2 by itself 10 times concurrently, in other terms 2 to the power 10, leading to an output of 1024. Additionally, we have the method accumulate and get, which accepts a functional interface of type int binary operator. In the example you see, we made use of this method to sum all the values from 0 to 10 concurrently. As an alternative to atomic classes, we can make use of adder classes. For example, the class longAdder can be used to consecutively add values to a number, as you can see in this example. LongAdder provides methods such as add and increment, which, just like the atomic class methods, are thread-safe. However, instead of summing up a single result, this class maintains a set of variables internally to avoid threads messing with each other, meaning the actual result of the summation should be retrieved by calling the sum or sum then reset method. This class is usually preferable over atomic numbers when updates from multiple threads are more common than reads. This is often the case when capturing statistical data. The drawback of longAdder is higher memory consumption because a set of variables is held in memory. Next are accumulator classes, which are the more generalized version of the adder classes. Take longAccumulator as an example. Instead of simply performing add or sum operations, the class longAccumulator builds around a functional interface of type longBinaryOperator, as shown in this code snippet. Here we created a longAccumulator with the function x times y and an initial value of 1. With every call to the accumulate method, both the current result and the value of I are passed as parameters to the lambda expression. A long accumulator, just like long adder, maintains a set of variables internally. In the second part of this video, we are going to tackle concurrent maps. Concurrent map is an interface that extends the map interface and defines one of the most useful concurrent collection types. Let's take a look at a few of its methods. The method for each accepts a byConsumer with both the key and value of the map passed as parameters. It can be used as a replacement for traditional for each loops to iterate over the key value pairs of a concurrent map, as the iteration is performed sequentially on the current thread. The method putIfAbsent puts a new value into the map only if no value exists for the given key. The implementation of this method is thread safe, just like its put counterpart, so you don't have to synchronize these calls if you're calling them from multiple threads. The method get or default returns the value for the given key. In case no entry exists for that key, the default value we passed is returned. The method replace all accepts a by function. By functions take two parameters and return a single value. In this case, the function is called with the key and the value of each map entry and returns a new value to be assigned to certain keys. Instead of replacing all values of the map, the compute method lets us transform a single entry. It accepts both the key and a by function to specify the transformation of the value corresponding to that key. Finally, the method merge can be utilized to unify a new value with an existing value in the map. Merge accepts a key, the new value to be merged into the existing entry, and a by function to specify the merging behavior of both values. All those methods above are part of the concurrent map interface, thereby available to all implementations of that interface. But in addition to this, the most important implementation, concurrent hash map, has been further enhanced with a few methods to perform parallel operations upon the map, the for each, search, and reduce methods. All of these methods are overloaded with a common first argument called parallelism threshold. This threshold indicates the minimum collection size when the operation should be executed in parallel. So, if you pass a threshold of 100 and the actual size of the map is 80, the operation will be performed sequentially on a single thread. Therefore, in the next examples, we'll use a threshold of 1 to always force parallel execution. First, the for each method calls a byConsumer with the key and value of the current iteration step. In order to visualize parallel execution, we are printing the current thread's name to the console. As you can see, with every run to this code snippet, the output will differ, and the thread handling the system.out operation may be different. The method search, on the other hand, accepts a by function that returns a null-null search result for the current key value pair, or null if the current iteration doesn't match the desired search criteria. As soon as a non-null result is returned, further processing is stopped. Keep in mind that concurrent hash map is unordered. The search function should not depend on the actual processing order of the map. What you see now is another example where we search solely on the values of the map. There is also an overloaded method that searches among keys. Feel free to check it out. Finally, the reduce method, already known from Java 8 streams, accepts two functional interfaces of type by function. The first function transforms each key value pair into a single value of any type. The second function combines all those transformed values into a single result while ignoring any possible null value. One sample output could be similar to the one in front of you. You see, what may differ are the threads handling the transform and reduce operations, but the final output result will always be the same. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.